Ladies and gentlemen, he's a child of God, a husband, NRA conservative, radical right-wing supervillain, and Twitter rock star. American by birth, Texan by choice, and a badass by nature. He's the owner of TomOHalloran.com, OHalloranMedia.com, and PatriotRadio.net. Please welcome Tom O'Halloran.
There ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the U.S.
Good morning, America. This is Friday, and this is Jihad on America. I'm your host, Tom O'Halloran, and I'm broadcasting today from my underground bunker deep in Arkansas, Brascarado. I'm here to educate, irritate, and agitate, and I guarantee you 100% agitation by the time this show's over. We've missed the show for a few weeks now. This is Jihad on America, our usual, there's nothing typical about it, but it's our usual Friday show. It's been preempted for the last couple of weeks for election stuff, but we are back and with a vengeance. Again, my name's Tom O'Halloran. My primary blog, TomOHalloran.com. When you get there, please follow my editor, Veronica Coffin. She manages several websites on our network, and without her doing that, I couldn't do this. You'll find her follow button at the bottom of each and every post. Find us on Facebook. We're at facebook.com/Patriot Radio Show. And don't forget to like us when you get over there. I'm on Facebook at facebook.com/O'Halloran. And I'm on air 5 days a week, folks. So if you're not tuning in 5 times a week, you're missing out. Please tune in 9 a.m. Texas time, Monday through Thursday, for the Patriot Radio Show. On Fridays, I do this, Jihad on America. Here I cover the Islamists in America. I tell you who they are, what they want, and why you should be afraid. If you've not heard my show on the Muslim Brotherhood, my show Islam is Not a Religion, or my show on Islamophobia, then please, 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 do yourself a favor. Do America a favor. Find your way to PatriotRadioShow.com. Listen to all three of these shows. They will give you insight and perspective on the Islamic topic that you've probably not heard elsewhere. They'll also give you a solid foundation upon which we build each and every Friday as we continue to pull back the mask of Islam, looking at what's being done in the name of Allah, both here and abroad. And as you'll find out in just a moment, I do the news about Islam around the world. And I do this because it's a look into the future of what's in store for us here in America if we continue to allow this cancer of Islam to spread here in the homeland. Keep abreast of my shows, listen to the live stream, as well as catch up on the archives of any shows that you may have missed, all at PatriotRadioShow.com. And folks, you can also listen to this show. It's being rebroadcast daily on the conservativeradionetwork.com. And beginning next week, it's back on. We had a little communications kerfluffle. But beginning on Monday, this show will be broadcast 3 times a day on the Liberty Works Radio Network. That's LWRN.com. You can also find us on your iPhone or your Android. Go to the App Store, download the Spreaker podcast app or the TuneIn app. Do a search for the Patriot Radio Show. And you'll have all of our shows with you wherever you go. beginning as we generally do on Jihad on America show, we're going to refresh our memory. We're going to bring you up to date what has been happening in the religion of peace in the last 30 days. In the last 30 days, there have been 126 attacks, with 998 people being killed, another 2,179 people being severely wounded. 22 of these attacks were suicide blasts. The attacks occurred in 22 different countries. In the last week, there were 38 attacks, with 261 being killed and 874 being severely wounded. Five of these were suicide blasts, and these attacks happened in 15 countries. And since 9/11, there have been 28,004 Islamic terrorist attacks. Now, in the past 30 days, the attacks have been all over the place. As we said, they've been in 22 countries in 30 days. These include, but are not limited to, Nigeria, with 18 dead and 35 severely wounded, as two female suicide bombers slaughtered 24 worshippers at a rival mosque. In Taza, Iraq, a 3-year-old girl dies from an ISIS chemical attack that left hundreds injured, one dead, 600 injured. Pakistan, a Jamatul Ahrar suicide bomber murders 17 people at a courthouse, including two children, another 30 wounded. Hilla, Iraq, at least 60 people are incinerated when a suicide bomber in a fuel tanker detonates outside a town. 61 dead, 95 wounded. Militant Muslims storm a Catholic retirement home in Yemen, murder 16, including 4 nuns. Two suicide bombers massacre 18 bystanders in Syria, with 18 dead and 30 wounded. Back to Iraq, 40 dead and 58 wounded as a Fedayeen suicide bomber detonates at a funeral, sending at least 40 mourners straight to their own afterlife. These are Muslims killing Muslims. My friends, I remind you, they are here to kill the infidels. They are here to kill you and me. But when they don't have enough infidels around, all they care about is who they can kill. They'll kill other sects of other Muslims. They'll kill Muslims of their own sect that they don't believe are pious enough. In Afghanistan, a suicide bomber targets a bus, killing 15. Another 31 severely wounded. Somalia, Mogadishu, holy warriors attack a youth league hotel with bombs and gunfire, killing 14 and wounding another 30. Back to Baghdad, two Sunni suicide bombers detonate a Shiite mosque, slaughtering at least 15 worshippers, another 50 seriously wounded. Nigeria again, radical Islamic mercenaries sweep through a series of Christian villages and slaughter over 300, including pregnant women and children. Afghanistan, a suicide bomber detonates near a clinic, taking 13 other souls with him, another 19 severely wounded. In Syria, a double bombing by ISIS along a commercial strip leaves nearly 60 dead and 200 burned and battered. This, my friends, is what they call the religion of peace. Syria, Damascus, children among 83 destroyed by a horrific suicide bombing outside a Shiite shrine and school. 83 dead, 178 severely wounded. Four Shahid suicide bombers massacre 24 others at a market in nearby school. 24 dead, 112 severely wounded. Syria, over a dozen people lose their lives during an ISIS bomb attack on several villages. That's 13 dead, another 24 severely wounded. Now, I'm not trying to say that all terrorists, I mean all Muslims are terrorists. This is not true. I am saying that all Muslims are followers of a goat-raping pedophile named Mohammed. But so as not to be nailed a negative ninny, as they say, I'm now going to talk about the good of Islam. I'm going to talk about all the contributions that Islam has brought to the world, something that we overlook on this show all too often. Today we're going to cover the good of Islam. And that covers that part of this show. There is no good from Islam. Islam has contributed nothing to society. Islam has done nothing. Muslims have invented nothing. All they do is destroy. It is a system of hatred, of domination. Muriel in the chat room says, Islam has shown us how to effectively behead a person. Yes, how could I have overlooked that? Actually, they say that Muslims actually invented the condom using the intestines of a goat. The British improved on the invention 100 or so years later by removing the intestine from the goat first. My friends, stick around. We're going to go pay some bills, but we'll be right back. We've got a whole lot to talk about today.
One place where you are guaranteed to find a great guy. You know, the kind of guy that carries you off on horseback and flies you to Paris and likes to talk about his feelings? He's at the movies. Well, in the movies. Where else will you find a funny architect with airbrushed abs? Girls are lining up for guys like this, but not you, because you bought your tickets ahead on Fandango. So adios, long lines, and hello, handsome astronaut, brain surgeon, spy.
Make a date with Fandango, your ticket to the movies.
Family night at the movies is a tradition. It really bonds us together. I love you guys so much. Especially this one. I mean, of course, there's all the, his popcorn's bigger than mine, and she's hitting me. Fandango makes it all so easy with tickets in advance. Honey, you enjoy the chick flick? Kids, you enjoy the animated movie? Daddy's gonna go watch things go boom. That's how we do family movie night.
Bring your family closer together with Fandango, your ticket to the movies.
Boost Mobile believes you deserve more choice.
You can pick your phone,
pick your plan,
and
you can even pick a new spokesperson
and a sell that phone.
The Samsung Galaxy S5 will rock your face off.
Give it to me through tears.
Get unlimited talk, text, and data. Starting at $40 a month.
Wow.
Pick your phone,
pick your plan,
and pick your next spokesperson at BoostMobile.com.
Visit Boost Mobile through the RER Marketplace.
Patriots, have you ever wondered why Google, Yahoo, AT&T, Comcast, and so many others offer free email? Who offers free stuff these days? They do it so that millions will sign up with them. Then as these people send what they think are private emails, the emails get scanned and tagged according to the content of the emails. These companies then sell your email addresses to companies that are selling things that you may be interested in based upon the content of your emails. If you're a veteran or if you have a vet in your family, go to usvetmail.net. Get an email address, your name at usvetmail.net. It's not only private, but it shows pride in your veteran or your pride of service. We never scan our clients' mail, and we never, ever sell or share your information with anyone. Thank you.
I reckon the storms are brewing. Reckon so.
Reckon you got a hotel?
Reckon no. Money's tight.
Reckon Priceline Express deals can get you a great deal wherever you mosey.
You reckon? We reckon. I reckon our work here is done. Vamanos!
Express deals. Priceline savings without the bidding.
Think he's happy?
Ooh, I reckon.
Tom O'Halloran, holding the line against tyranny from Washington, D.C.
I am America, one voice, united we stand. I am America, one hope to heal our land. There is still work that must be done. I will not rest until we
welcome back. It's Jihad on America on a Friday morning. I'm your host, Tom O'Halloran. The foes of free speech are closing in, both from the government and private sector. Now, we spoke a little bit on this topic yesterday, and I believe the conversation was more in the chat room than it was on air. But Facebook and Twitter, social media sites controlling content. A lot of conservatives object to this, and they complain, which is their right. But you don't complain about your First Amendment rights when a company controls the content on their servers. The First Amendment is there to protect us from the government. The government cannot shut us down for our speech. The government cannot say that we cannot talk about certain topics. It does not control private enterprise. As upset as I was over Twitter muzzling my accounts, deleting my accounts, deleting my followers, deleting my tweets, I've never had the problem with Facebook. Some people say Facebook is worse. It is their right as a private company. And I was reminded of the comment from Nathan Hale or someone. It may not have been him. It was attributed to him yesterday. That may or may not be the source. He said, "I may disagree with what you say, but I will defend you to my death for your right to say it." Well, the same goes in the obverse. Twitter and Facebook have objections about conservative talk. It is their server. It is their network. They have a right to say that you can or you cannot talk about that topic. You can say those things on this network or not. The same as I have a right to control this radio show. If somebody calls in and starts talking in a manner that I find distasteful or disagreeable, then I have a right to push the mute button and make them moot. Facebook is doing this on a regular basis. Our friend Pamela Geller had another website shut down from Facebook this last week. It was a page called Islamic Jew Hatred. It is in the Quran. The page was taken down because it was, quote, hate speech. Hate speech? Really? The page ran the actual Quranic texts and teachings that called for hatred and incitement of violence against Jews. So exactly what was responsible? Who was exactly responsible for the hate speech that may have been presented on the page? Despite its content being simply factual, the page was taken down. It was only up 2 weeks and it had 10,000 followers. Of course, she started a new page almost immediately. Islamic anti-Semitism. It is in the Quran. But she expects it'll be taken down as well. The problem isn't that Facebook is doing this. The problem is why they are doing this. This is Sharia. This is Sharia. Under Sharia law, you cannot speak bad about the Quran, no matter how factual your words are. If you've not heard my show on Islamophobia, I beg you, please go to patriotradioshow.com. Listen to the show on Islamophobia. You are called an Islamophobe. You are called a bigot if you say anything that paints Islam in a negative light, no matter how factual your words are. I'm going to bring you up to date here in the chat room. Richard in the chat room saying, it is not if it is unethical behavior and they are scamming people. If you say they are providing a service honestly, but do the opposite, it is violating the laws. This is for the private companies shutting down conservatives. Catherine says, yep, but the government now controls the internet, but uses the front of the private companies. And this is a real concern. How much of these policies are actually coming from the CEO and the board of directors, and how much is being driven by government pressure? Catherine also says the way private companies is the way the government controls what info is put out. And Twitter and Facebook are both publicly traded companies now. They have no rights. I'm not sure that's the truth, Richard. It may put them in a different class of that, but they're still a company that has their right to do things. That's an interesting thought, though. I'm going to have to look into that. They may not. They may not. If it's a publicly traded company, their personal control may diminish. That's worth looking into. Muriel, on Twitter, on Super Tuesday, there was one tweet supposedly from Anonymous stating it was going to take down make public the sex exploits of Ted Cruz. And later that day, another tweet supposedly from Anonymous stating they are going to tweet hidden info about Hillary and Sanders. So are these Anonymous postings really from Anonymous, or people using the Anonymous name? There are hundreds of Anonymous accounts. They use the same avatar, but they have hundreds of different ways of saying that that's who they are. So it's not really, it's like the Tea Party. It's not really a formalized group. It's more of a philosophy. And there is some networking, and some of the people know each other, and so forth and so on. Muriel, Islam and the BLM are closely aligned in their belief that only their points of view is to be allowed. Good point. Catherine says, I agree, they will condemn others who do not share their views. Well, it's more than just the BLM, because the reason I brought this topic up is the Democrats are pushing a very, very dangerous bill. House Resolution 56 or 569 was sponsored back in December. Now, I just pulled this up late last night. I've not done the research. We will do so in the next few days. And hopefully have a report for you this next week. But it was sponsored by Muslim Congressman Keith Ellison and Andre Carson, as well as by Eleanor Holmes Norton, Loretta Sanchez, Charles Rangel, Debbie Wasserman Schultz, Joe Kennedy, and many, many more. John Conyers. House Resolution 569 condemns violence, bigotry, and hateful rhetoric toward Muslims in the United States. Lumping together hate speech and violence is a dangerous concept. And this resolution condemns violence, bigotry, and hateful rhetoric. Combining the two in the same sentence implies that simply criticizing Islam is equal to actual violent acts. And we heard Attorney General Loretta Lynch say just a couple of months back, that they will prosecute those that speak ill of Islam. Now, she tried to walk that back, but you can't put that toothpaste back in the tube. Her intent, her desire, is to punish those who speak ill of Islam. The inclusions of the condemnations of bigotry and hateful rhetoric in this resolution, while appearing to be high-minded, take on an ominous character when one recalls the fact that for years, Ellison, Carson, and their allies in CARE have been smearing any and all honest examination of how Islamic jihadists use the texts and teachings of Islam to incite hatred and violence as bigotry and hateful rhetoric. If they had their way, my show would be shut down post-haste. This resolution is using the specter of violence against Muslims to try to quash legitimate research into the motives and goals of those who have vowed to destroy us, which will have the effect of allowing jihad to advance to unimpeded, and then it would be unopposed. Why are we so interested in protecting Muslims? What have they done to earn this special attention? Christians don't get a special resolution. Neither do the Irish. And I say Irish because I am Irish. But while I'm at it, the Irish, including my family, have contributed greatly to the culture and economic fabric and well-being of the United States society. We've already covered what the Islamists have contributed. Crickets. Their only contribution to American society is dropping our towers, beheading our employees, shooting our soldiers. Terrorist attacks on Islamic, on U.S. soil. All I see from these people are lawsuits because they refuse to remove the rags off their heads or deliver alcohol, or poisoning our schools with their backwards beliefs and complaining about ham and bacon. Not to mention, they have to kneel on the ground 20 times a day to worship Allah after washing their stinking feet in our sinks. I suppose I sound a tad unhinged, but we have a big problem, folks. When Muslims become more important than the rest of us in the eyes of our government, we're in deep, deep doo-doo. Dom the Conservative over at Mad World News sums it up perfectly. He says, in conclusion, the bill ridiculously compares criticizing Islam as a violation of Muslims' civil rights, as if disagreeing or even openly mocking someone's belief is unconstitutional. Our forefathers had exactly political and religious mockery in their mind when they penned our amendments, having experienced the violation of limited speech and worship by their own King George III. Indeed, he says, free speech was never intended to defend inoffensive speech. Because inoffensive speech needs no protection. Freedom of speech is solely for the offensive, meant to preserve, to prevent those who would limit it because of their opposing beliefs. We're witnessing the very implementation of Sharia law as it has always been established in every modern-day Islamic country. Of course, they wouldn't start by legalizing the execution of homosexuals or mandating the hijab for every woman, because we wouldn't accept being forced to adopt full Sharia right off the bat. You can't cook a frog by dropping it into boiling water. It would jump out instantly. But this one step at a time, little baby steps, they implement Sharia, and we don't even see it coming. Well, we do, because we are aware, because we are awake. Most of America, however, is not. Once we lost our freedom of speech, all of our other freedoms will follow. This is well known and is intended by the Islamic community, the majority of whom admit they want Sharia law. Yes, here in America, 85% of all polled Muslims say they would support Sharia law in the United States of America. The only way to stop them from infringing upon our speech is to use it. Now more than ever, we must speak out against stealth jihad and fascism that seeks to overthrow our constitution for a religious and political legislature. Lest we substitute one tyrant for new tyrant of old for new ones. We must not let this stuff happen without raising hell. Tell people what is going on. Send them links to the show. Send them links to the three shows I talk about at the opening of every radio show. To the Islam is not a religion. To the Sharia or Islamophobia show. Let people know what is happening. We actually have two Muslims in Congress that are behind this drive. That are behind the drive to implement Sharia here in the United States. Are we going to go along with it and allow it? Or are we going to raise hell and make sure we stop it? The choice is ours, but not for long. Stick around, my friend. We've got a lot more coming up after this. It's Jihad on America on a Friday morning.
It's that time again. It's what you've been dreading all year. It can be confusing, difficult, even painful. It has driven countless people to worry and to despair. It's something you hate, but something you have to do. It gets under your skin, and it can get you in over your head. It is income taxes. Now it is easier. It is faster. It can make you happy. It is less expensive than H&R Block and TurboTax. It will get you your biggest refund faster. It starts free. It is eFile.com. eFile.com. We make income taxes fast and easy.
How's it going, JR fans? Nick Libretti here, and today we're smoking the Oliva Cane Daytona. Another home run from the Oliva company. Guys, this is the Cane Daytona. medium to full body Nicaraguan smoke, Habano wrapper on it, burns really, really nice. Hints of coffee, really, really creamy, flavorful smoke. This thing changes flavors on me four or five times throughout the cigar. It's excellent. Three words I would use to describe this thing: impeccable, complex, and out of this world. That's more than three words. Stop counting. We have three sizes, everything from a 46 to a 60 ring gauge. Get them right now at jrcigars.com.
Hi there, my name is Mark Kranenberg, and welcome to my kitchen. Today we're going to talk about my favorite order from Chicago Steak Company. It's the Classic Crime Assortment. All right, well, let's open up and have a look what's inside. So right away, we've got 2 6-ounce filet mignons. If you know anything about steak, it's really rare to see filet mignons with that kind of marbling in it. Just beautiful steak. And then next, we've got the 2 12-ounce USDA prime strip steaks. Just look at how thick these things are. They're just beautiful. Again, beautifully marbled, amazing steak. Then we've got 2 USDA prime ribeyes. And if you like steak that is just mouth-watering, this is the steak for you. With all that marbling inside, you'll see it's thicker. The marbling is a lot thicker. That just means more moisture throughout your steak. Now we've got 6 USDA prime top sirloin steaks. These are the steaks that everyone's gonna love. Then we're moving into our next package. Next, we have 16 4-ounce gourmet Angus steak burgers. These are amazing burgers that everyone's gonna love. And to top it all off, they give you one container of my favorite steak seasoning of all time, the Chicago Steak Spice, and you're gonna love it too. So there you have the Classic Prime Assortment, my favorite and your ultimate steak experience. So be sure to order your steak today at mychicagosteak.com. I'm Mark. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, and we'll see you next time at mychicagosteak.com.
Tom O'Halloran.
We'll put a boot in your ass. It's the American way. All brought to you courtesy of the red, white, and blue. Oh, of my red, white, and blue.
And we are back. This is Jihad on America on a Friday morning. I'm your host, Tom O'Halloran. Switching gears, going back, we are talking about Pakistan now. Leading Muslim groups say that a law protecting women from abuse is un-Islamic. Western feminists, where are you? Why do they have nothing to say about this? This is the most misogynist ideology on the face of the earth, and yet American women, the feminists, are mum. They never say a word about Islam. Pakistan's religious groups say protecting women from abuse is un-Islamic. An all-parties conference convened by Pakistan's oldest Islamic political party and attended by powerful religious groups asked the government on Tuesday to retract an un-Islamic law that gives unprecedented protection to female victims of violence. This is a relatively new law, and the Muzzies are all up in arms. The Women's Protection Act, passed by Pakistan's largest province of Punjab last month, gives legal protection to women from domestic, psychological, and sexual violence. How dare this government do this? How dare they actually protect women? Men cannot beat their wives anymore. They no longer have a right to rape their own wives or kick them. The controversial law to protect women was promulgated to accomplish the West's agenda to destroy the family system in Pakistan, read the joint declaration issued at the end of the conference. This act is redundant and would add to the miseries of women. Poor women wouldn't be able to be abused and beat with a stick. Prime Minister Sharif heard our reservations against the Punjab Protection of Women Act and has promised to amend the law so that it doesn't contravene to the teachings of the Holy Quran. Oh good, Islam is saved. They can beat their women again. Earlier this month, the Council on Islamic Ideology, a powerful Pakistani religious body that advises the government on compatibility of laws with Islam, declared the Women's Protection Act un-Islamic. But they're going to fix that, folks, so don't worry. They'll be back to raping women. Well, they're probably still raping them. They just ignored the law. Coming out of the chat room, it's Muriel. It says, people, especially the younger ones, are being brainwashed into believing that we are all treating Islam unfairly. They don't read the Quran. They don't know the Islamic beliefs except for what they're being told by their teachers or professors, and yet do believe they have all the answers. Yes, they're useful idiots, as they say. They're incapable of doing independent homework to find the truth about things. No, I think they're being taught they don't need to do homework. That's what their professors are for, to tell them what they need to know. Catherine says, a quick fact about Hillary. Yeah, a little off topic. So it goes on about women's rights, but she's the first one of her class in the 70s was defending a rapist of a 12-year-old girl. Yes, she did. Yes, she did. Mira says, I read about that. She was happy. She actually got the rapist off by portraying a 12-year-old child as promiscuous, if I'm not mistaken. Germany. If you recall, we covered this quite heavily during the first few weeks of the new year. For the New Year's celebration, the city of Cologne, in one train station, there were over 1,000 sexual assaults that one night. Many of them rapes, some of them some of them were gropes, tearing girls' clothes off, but many of the women were raped. The German government has agreed to reform the country's rape laws to protect victims and encourage reports of sexual assault in the wake of the New Year's Cologne attacks. Rape laws set to be extended so as to cover cases of sexual assault where it cannot be proven that the victim physically resisted an attacker. If you can believe this, in Germany today, a woman trying to press charges for rape must prove that she not only verbally said no, but also that she tried to fight the rapist off. How do you fight off five guys? How do you fight off a guy that's got a gun to your head? How do you prove that you physically resisted when a guy's got a gun shoved down your throat? And yet, if they did not have this kind of proof, they couldn't press rape charges. This isn't far from Sharia law. In Sharia law, you have to have four witnesses. Can you imagine? You cannot press charges of rape unless you've got four witnesses. If he doesn't bring his friends, and they're not going to be your witnesses, they're going to be his witnesses. So if he doesn't rape you in front of four other women, tough luck. They'll stone you for being a whore is what happens. They'll stone you for being a whore if you get raped. Disgusting, isn't it? Fact is, under the current law, rape victims must not only prove that they refused consent, but they also physically resisted the attacker. And because of this, only 8% of rape trials end in convictions. As it stands, only 10% of rapes in Germany are even reported to the police. Only 10% of rapes get reported. And only 8% of rape trials end in convictions. So for every 1,000 rapes, 100 men will go to trial. And 92 will walk away free. 92 will walk away. Catherine in the chat room, sorry, Tom, your women's rights topic made me think about it, but I do believe that Hillary also studied Islam. I'm not sure whether she studied it or whether she got it. In the early years, she got all of her knowledge about Islam from her daughter, who went to college and came home knowledgeable about Islam. She proudly stated, I learned everything I know about Islam from Chelsea. Now, she may have studied it since then, but her initial information was from that. Of course, she had a lesbian lover slash personal aide in Uma Abedin, and she probably learned a fair amount from that as well. So rape reform finally in Germany, bringing them into the 20th century. Running out of time. Let's see. Converting Denmark into a Muslim country. Numerous cities in Denmark have no-go zones. Zones where the Danish police will not even go. We've talked about these all through the UK, in France, in Italy, in Sweden, in Dearborn, Michigan. When the Islamic numbers get significant in a certain location, the Muslims get more aggressive. If you want to hear more about this, go to patriotradioshow.com. Listen to my show, Islam is Not a Religion. I spell it out in great detail. In a town, I'm not even going to try to pronounce it. Danish words are just unbelievable. About 20 miles north of Copenhagen, where Arab and Turkish immigrants now comprise more than half of the total population. They denied the community's request to spend $1,200 for the community's annual Christmas event. And then at the same meeting, they approved $10,000 on a large communal celebration for the Muslim holiday. 5 out of 9 of the board members are Muslims. And they're doing away with all Christian, with all traditional Norwegian holidays. And only Islamic traditions will now be recognized. A news truck pulled up to a meeting to do a story. And as soon as the truck pulled up, the truck was pelted with bricks and rocks. They were attacked by 25 masked hoodlums just for wanting to do a story on the Christmas tree being denied. The local police has sided with the Muslim attackers, blaming the journalists for sending a television truck into the area. What were you thinking, trying to cover a news story? Who do you think you are, journalists? It's your fault. It's always the victim's fault, isn't it? If she didn't want to be raped, she wouldn't have been a woman. Town after town, we see it happening through the EU. These immigrants come in, and they'll ship enough of them to a small town to completely overtake the town. They overtake the community, this town hall, a town council, and start implementing Sharia law immediately. The gangs in Denmark, there are now over 700 of them in the Copenhagen area alone. There are a dozen different gangs involved in all sorts of crime. It's pathetic. You open your country and welcome these people in, and all of a sudden they're taking over your communities, getting involved in drug trafficking, weapon smuggling, extortion, human trafficking, robbery, prostitution, automobile theft, racketeering, and murder. Gang members are Arabs, Bosnians, Turks, Somalis. Also, Iraqis, Moroccans, Palestinians, Pakistanis, anywhere that has Muslims in the community, you will find Muslim gang members. Reason behind it is a recent report out of Germany points out that two-thirds of Muslims coming through are illiterate. They can't so much as read a bus schedule. 85% of them can't read at a third grade level. Germans are saying it would take about $80,000 a year for a class of 25. And they'd need to stay in this class for 2.5 years. And yet, 75% of the people that have taken the current class, trainees from Syria and Afghanistan and Iraq, 75% of them that started the class a year ago have already dropped out. $80,000 for a 25-person class, and they have over 1 million of these scumbag savages in their country in the last year alone. Unbelievable, my friends. 81% of the migrants to Germany are unskilled, and just 8% had any academic qualifications at all. Muriel mentioned in the chat room that their inbreeding has caused serious problems. Yes, we've covered this on the show many times. They have been inbreeding for generation after generation. They have more mental diseases, mental retardation. If you look at any of the mental hospitals throughout the entire EU, you'll find them filled with 95% of them are Muslims. That's what happens when you have sex with your sister and cousin, mother. Stick to the goats, people. God bless you and yours, America. This is Tom O'Halloran. I'm out. May you all have a very, very blessed weekend. Shout out to my dear friend up north in Potato Land, Charlie. Have a nice weekend, honey. Thanks to everybody in the chat room, my regulars, Richard, Catherine, Muriel. Say hi to Mike. God bless y'all.